In the world of popular music, where fashion is everything, 1955 was all about Calypso.
Sad to say I'm on my way, won't be back for many a day.
Meanwhile, 3,000 miles away from the Caribbean in Palo Alto, California, a young graduate student from Stanford University called Dave Gard got together with two of his friends, Nick Reynolds and Bob Shane, and they formed a trio.
Tick, 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 everybody look in, tick, 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 see them all searching, tick, 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 that's all they hear, but you couldn't find out where to watch was hiding.
Oh, Shannon, I long to hear you.
They knew that musical ability wasn't enough, wasn't going to keep their audiences entertained. So they developed an act based on comedy. They practiced and rehearsed and got it absolutely right. They sounded spontaneous every night, and it paid off, because they got booked into one of the most prestigious and important venues in San Francisco, the Purple Onion. And one night, a member of the audience was Bob Hope's agent. He saw them, he liked them, and he introduced them to executive producer at Capitol Records, Voyle Gilmore. But the executives at Capitol Records had a problem pigeonholing them. They had a problem with branding.
They heard all the songs we did and stuff, and I heard them talking amongst themselves. Then it said, well, I think maybe we should call them folk singers. And we said, why? He said, well, there really wasn't anything that I could tell you about. You just so many different kinds of songs that it must be folk songs. And so we said, okay. And they said, we think we're going to make some big things happen for you, and you might probably make them a lot of money. And we said, oh, great, call me anything you want.
Their first single was based on this old folk song.
Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, poor boy, you're bound to die.
Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley.
Tom Dooley topped the Billboard charts and sold over 3 million copies.
They wanted to give us a Grammy for this. The first year of the Grammys in 58. And so they looked around and found out they didn't have a folk singing category yet. So what do we do now? So they looked around further and said, country music in 57 and 58 was dead in sales. And so they said, we got to help them out. So they gave us the first Grammy ever given for best country and western presentation of the year.
The trio's initial success was remarkable. In a three-year period, starting 1957, they recorded 5 studio albums, all number one hits. By 1961, the group had sold more than 8 million records. They earned $25 million for Capitol. Today, that would be $220 million. And in 1960, the Kingston Trio was responsible for a staggering 20% of Capitol Records' total sales.
Wished I had a dollar, and I wished I had a dime. I'd buy a jug of cider and stay happy all the time.
Get along home, Lindy, get along home. Get along home, Lindy, how merry sometimes.
They were open, they were joyous, they were welcoming. And singing the songs of the Kingston Trio at the time was not unlike people singing Beatles songs in a later era.
I've been away on a business trip, traveling all around. I've got a gal and her name is Sue, prettiest gal in town. She sets my mind to worrying, every time I'm gone, I'll be home tonight. So I won't be worried long.
It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I'm worried now, but won't be worried long.
And then in 1961, founder member Dave Gard made one of the most disastrous career decisions ever. He walked away from the trio.
You know, there was no reason to tell the public why it was. We yeah. never really did tell them why, because it got down to the point where Time magazine said that after interviewing Dave, that he felt that it wasn't going anywhere because Nick and Bob refused to learn any new styles and so forth and so on, or whatever they were doing. They never once had quoted us and saying, gee, Dave, we seem to have done quite well so far. We're the biggest selling group in the world. You know, what do we want to change for?
So it was a crisis. No Dave Gard. Was this going to be the end of the Kingston Trio? No, because Dave Gard's place was taken by a young singer-songwriter called John Stewart, and he fitted right in.
Thank you very much. We'd like to do a modern-day traveling song now about jet planes and airports. And it's all about the early morning rain, and it's called The Early Morning Rain. One,
groups really admire the Kingstons. The Kingstons had set the tone and gave people the appetite for this kind of music. So they were very grateful and listened to every new album that the trio came out with.
Yeah, about a six-string Martin, a guitar, because that's what the guys played. You could see it on the album covers, and hey, that's the sound, that's what we want to have.
And my friends and I started playing, copying the Kingston Trio. We became a little group called Tim, Tom, and Ron. We tried to find matching striped shirts and black slacks with white socks, and I was Nick Reynolds. I bought the cheap copy of a Martin tenor guitar. I learned how to play it.
So here we are in the Tijuana jail. Ain't got no friends to go a bail. So here we'll stay, cause we can't pay. Just send our mail to the Tijuana jail.
I was shooting dice, breaking in the dough.
Bob told me that, It's really amazing to me that I even say Bob and Nick, you know, that I even knew these guys, because they were like, yeah. they were my Beatles, yeah, you know, yeah. Way back when. But Bob told me that when Nick joined he and Dave Gard, that Nick didn't know how to strum anything. So Bob gave him a tenor guitar because it only had four strings, taught him like three or four chords. And then if you look at a YouTube of any kind of song that might be a little bit more intricate, yeah, yeah. that might have some passing chords, Nick just skipped them. And he went to the next part. And it was really great, you know, nobody knew. But on the other hand, his tenor guitar really added, because he always capoed it up real high, so it was in a higher register, and it added a whole other depth to things. I mean, it's like his simplicity was a total bonus to the sound.
I stop the Jambi sails, see how the mainsail set.
We had a top 10 hit with Sloop John B, which was something that finally, due to my persistence, became, I think, one of our better songs, production.
Thank you. From that enormous applause, am I correct in assuming that you're in the entertainment world?
Yes, you are.
Sir?
Would your principal contribution to entertainment come in the motion picture field?
No, sir. That's one down and nine to go, Miss Francis.
Would it be the recording field?
Let me say this, that you're right in assuming the recording
field.
I thought I heard three men's voices. Did I? Miss Newman?
Are you the Kingston Trio?
Yes. How did you get the name, the Kingston Trio?
Well, when we first started thinking about doing this professionally, we needed a name real fast, and we were doing a lot of Calypso at the time, Mr. Belafonte in Kingston Town and Kingston, Jamaica. So we just made up a name real fast one night in the car.
Called Kingston, so you named it?
Right, Kingston, Jamaica.
I was impressed with the spice that they put into their arrangements, which I think was responsible for their success. There was always one little added spice that just made their arrangements interesting.
Well, no matter where I wander, I know I'll always find a welcome at the end of every journey. There'll be friendly people waiting. California would not hold me, though I love her timber mountains. Her fields and worked her orchards up and down her central valley.
But as they say, all good things must come to an end, and in 1967, Nick, Bob, and John, the Kingston Trio, broke up.
Scotch and soda, blood in your eye. Maybe do I feel high? Oh me, oh my. Do I feel high?
After a decade of traveling all over the world, Nick Reynolds was tired, and he just wanted to retire.
Dry martini, jigger of gin.
John Stewart continued touring, recording, and writing. But Bob Shane kept the spirit alive.
People won't believe me.
Over the next 50 years, he created a succession of Kingston Trio groups and Kingston Trio tribute groups. The personnel came and went, guys like Bill Zorn and George Grove.
I do, still be on the wagon.
And the audiences kept coming. In 1981, there was a reunion concert, an emotional affair. John Stewart was back.
I'd like to do a song now that I wrote with John Phillips from the Mamas and Papas way back in the early 60s. A song called Chilly Winds.
I'm going where them chilly winds don't blow.
And so was Dave Gard.
Back to back, belly to belly, well, I don't give a damn, cause I done that already. Back to back, belly to belly, at the zombie jamboree.
And here's the poignant last performance, the last time ever in 2008, when Nick Reynolds, Bob Shane, and John Stewart sang together.
Where all the flowers are. Long time passing, where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago.
So, why were the Kingston Trio so popular? And why for so long? Well, Bob Shane always said he thought of the Kingston Trio as musical entertainers. They were not folk singers. They weren't pretentious. Most of the protest singers of the time wore their political ideas on their sleeves. They were preachy. They were activists masquerading as entertainers, but not the Kingston Trio. They conveyed the sort of light-hearted optimism of mainstream America at the onset of the 1960s.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
Let the word go forth from this day on.
of the new generation has been born. Born to the task to keep us free, but proud of the rights of the home country. This is the new frontier. This is the new frontier.
And what about the unintended consequences of the Kingston Trio? As you've seen, they inspired a generation of new performers. And because the banjo was featured so heavily in their music, Vega Banjos actually had to hire extra workers in their factory to keep up with the demand. And Martin Guitars also paid the Kingston Trio a tribute. They said they changed everything about popular music and the entire acoustic guitar industry along with it. The Kingston Trio established Martin as America's guitar. All the original members of the Kingston Trio now have passed away. Dave Gard and Nick Reynolds, John Stewart. Bob Shane was the last one to pass in 2020, and he worked joyously till the end. So here's his last video, backed by George Grove, Bill Zorn, and Rick Doherty, all members at one time or another of that most popular group of the day, the Kingston Trio.
Let us go to the banks of the ocean, where the walls rise above the cider sea. Long ago, I used to be a young man, and dear Margaret remembers that for me.